We are live at 5. It's Monday, July 27th. I'm Paul Wontorek.
And I'm Charlie Cooper.
Hey, Charlie.
Hey, fresh face on the scene. I know. Glad to be here.
So good to have you here. So just so everybody knows, Charlie is one of our new correspondents. And, you know, you were supposed to start, like, a long time ago. And then the coronavirus, like, the coronavirus screwed up everything. So
she threw a wrench in everything. And it's okay.
We're very, very happy to have you here and to introduce you to everybody. Hey, we have two fantastic guests today. Do you know who they are?
Yes, we have Sydney Lucas.
Sydney Lucas.
And we have
Eli Tokash.
Yes.
Am I saying his name right? Am I saying his name right, Eli? Yep. Eli Tokash. They have a brand new podcast called Take a Bow. I've been listening to it all day. And I thought Take a Bow was just my favorite Madonna song, but it's actually a fantastic.
Is that your favorite now?
Yeah. It's fantastic. They're fantastic. Can't wait to talk to them. Let's do a little bit of news first.
Totally. So we're going to start off. So we're kicking things off with Alan Menken. He has 11 Grammy Awards, 8 Academy Awards, and a Tony under his belt. Now, on July 26th, he officially joined the ranks of EGOT winners, people who have Emmys, Grammys, Oscars, and Tony Awards. So that's a pretty big deal.
Huge, upon, huge deal.
Yeah, upon earning a Daytime Emmy Award for composing the song Waiting in the Wings with Glenn Slater for the Disney Channel show Rapunzel's Tangled Adventure. This is Menken's first competitive Emmy win. He received a special Emmy Award in 1990 for his contribution to the anti-drug special for children, Wonderful Ways to Say No. Menken is known for scoring Disney's, okay, these are huge names. So Disney's The Little Mermaid, Beauty and the Beast, Aladdin, Hercules, and Newsies. I mean, have you heard of those? Of course, yeah, who hasn't,
big
right?
Big hits.
A revival of Little Shop of Horrors, his 1982 breakout musical hit with longtime collaborator Howard Ashman, was running at Off-Broadway's West Side Theater prior to COVID-19. So this is a pretty big deal.
Big deal, big deal. Congrats, Alan Menken.
Totally.
And then also, everyone's talking about murder mysteries. There's a lot of that stuff happening right now. Andrew Barth Feldman was here last week talking about this little thing he has cooking up. And now we found out about a killer party, a murder mystery musical that's happening online. I think this has been, they've been filming it. It's an original musical series. And it's Michael James Scott, who you guys know. He'll be here tomorrow, by the way. He plays Barthur MacArthur, an artistic director of failing theater in Duluth, who invites a troupe of disgruntled actors and collaborators to read a murder mystery dinner party. And I think things go crazy. But listen to this cast. Alex Newell, Jeremy Jordan, Jackie Burns, Miguel Cervantes, Laura Alstis, Carly Carmelo, Jared Spector, Jessica Keenan-Wynn, Kristen Alabado, and Drew Galen. This is a crazy, crazy cast. 9-episode musical. They made the whole thing in quarantine. And Mark Bruni is the director. He's a fancy director. And has music by Jason Howland, lyrics by Nathan Tyson, and a book by Kate Kerrigan. This is a really fantastic group of people. I can't wait to check it out.
Same. It's, I mean, bound to be good with all those stars. In addition to watching Christopher Jackson as George Washington and Hamilton on Disney Plus or in Hulu's We Are Freestyle Love Supreme documentary, fans of the smooth voice talent can see him take the stage on August 15th at 7 p.m. Eastern. The Tony nominee will perform from New World Stages for a one-night-only concert that will be live-streamed. So, of course, you'll want to catch that one night only. I mean, come on. Proceeds from Christopher Jackson Live from the West Side will benefit the nonprofit theater company Dallas Summer Musicals. Jackson will perform show tunes, pop hits, and original songs with a live band, as well as share personal stories. Those tuning in will even have the chance to text questions and make special requests in real time. And in addition to his work on Broadway and Hamilton, Holla If You Hear Me, Bronx Bombers, After Midnight, Memphis, The Lion King, In the Heights, and Freestyle Love Supreme, Jackson is Grammy and Emmy Award winner. He's featured in the cast of the CBS drama Bull.
And he's just like the nicest guy ever. So
that always
speaking
helps.
Speaking of lovely people, Olivia de Havilland died over the weekend, 104 years old.
Amazing.
I mean, what an icon. Of course, she's very famous for playing Melanie in Gone with the Wind. I remember growing up, my mom, I love Scarlett O'Hara because she was sassy and ridiculous. And my mom was a big Melanie. My mom loved Melanie. So so I always paid attention to Melanie. Olivia de Havilland, she died in Paris at the age of 104. Yeah. She had 2 Oscars, 5 nominations. Check this out. She got nominated in 1940 for Gone with the Wind, lost to Heidi McDaniel. Not a bad way to lose. Right. 41, nominated the next year. 46, she 1946, she won. 1948, nominated again. And then she won again in 1949. So she was a huge, huge star of the golden age of Hollywood. That was just like a big chunk of career success. Absolutely. But what I didn't know is that then after that, in the 50s, she came to Broadway 3 times. She made her debut in 1951, playing Juliet in Romeo and Juliet at the Broadhurst. Then she was Candida in Candida. And then she did an original play opposite Henry Fonda called A Gift of Time. So she also recently made the news because as she was celebrating her 104th birthday.
I know. It doesn't get old.
She was spotted riding a bike. She apparently over years always rode her bike.
How cute.
Her dolled up, 104 years old, riding her bike. Come on. Wow. I mean, rest in peace, Olivia de Havilland. What a great, fantastic, full life. I love it.
Exactly. Totally.
Now, Charlie, since you're here, I want to share with everybody. So you are a very super fantastic, talented reporter. Everyone will see that.
Thank you.
But you also are featured. You're going to be featured on the site. You're also in our show, Broadway Profiles, with Tamsin Fadal. And I want to show a quick clip. You actually, everyone's wondering about how theater is going to come back. And you actually got to talk to Andy Senor, who is a well-loved Broadway. He was in Rent on Broadway, and he directed Rent many times. And now he actually has a production in South Korea, which is crazy, but there's a real production happening. And you got to talk to him. What was that like?
Yeah, it was a big deal. I mean, just the simple fact that they are able to put on theater right now where theater is dark in so many places, including where we are. And so it's just incredible to see how they were able to responsibly put on theater in Seoul, South Korea. And, you know, he has a huge history when it comes to Rent in general. And so we kind of talked about how he put that production on, but did so in the age of coronavirus and just found really creative ways to do that.
How do you write a song when the chords sound wrong, though they once sounded right and red?
How do you put on a show in a responsible way? Because Rent is one of those productions where people are close. They're taking up space in close proximities. They're singing in each other's faces. So how do you responsibly put on a show like that?
It starts at home. It starts at people making sure that they're not going out and they're not doing anything that is unnecessary. Then coming into the rehearsal space, as soon as you walk into the building, there's a camera that's taking your temperature. There, you're signing in, you're putting in your temperature, you're cleaning your hands, you're changing your shoes. An hour before, the staff is, they sanitize all the props in the set. And then you're in the rehearsal studio and you know, rehearse Rent as usual with the, you know, closeness, touching, making out, all of that. That's all there. And then you go home and just make sure that you're living responsibly.
Now it's almost like they're kind of leading the way in Seoul, South Korea. Is there a sense of pride in the air that you feel?
You know what? No, because it's for them, it's just commonplace. They live with, and they're very much used to living with airborne viruses. Mm-hmm. So, and they were just like, oh yeah, business as usual. Oh, there's a virus. Okay, right. We wear masks. We don't go out and we wash our hands. And we just, it was pretty commonplace for them. They're also, people seem to be very obedient in regards to what the rules are. And if, you know, if it says wear masks, everybody's wearing their masks. And people are very responsible when it comes to that. So I wouldn't say they were prideful. I would just say that they felt, honestly, that they felt honored that they were being recognized.
How cool.
Fantastic. I wish I could see Rent right now.
Seriously. I love that show. One of my favorites. Same.
So We're going to get to Eli and Sydney in just a minute, but today I want to talk about today's Today in Broadway. So every day we're trying to give you guys a little bit of a history lesson because this is a good time for us to learn stuff. And I want to talk today about the Selwyn Theater, which was a big fancy theater on 42nd Street. And it was built in 1918 by this architect named George Keister, who also designed the Apollo Theater, by the way, and the Belasco. And look, oh, I love this picture because this is from the Billy Rose collection. But I love that there's something called Girl from 10th Avenue playing there in the picture. And I was like, I need to know what that's about. And apparently it was about a drunk guy who met a girl on 10th Avenue. And then they went out drinking. So anyway, now you know. It's a Betty Davis movie. So check that out. Anyway, I want to talk about the Selwyn Theater because it ties in today. It opened in 1918, as I said, and it was a big deal because they had separate smoking rooms for men and women. The theater was so different back then. I mean, you go from that Rent piece to talking about like the fact that people had, that's never going to happen again. Anyway, and then it became a movie theater, and then it became probably like in, you know, a lot of theaters on 42nd Street weren't doing really great things in the 70s, and it became one of those theaters. But you guys know this theater because now it's the American Airlines Theater, the gorgeous theater that Roundabout Theater took over in the late 90s and renovated, and they opened officially 20 years ago today on August 27th, I had to look at the date, the year 2000, with Nathan Lane. Nathan Lane and The Man Who Came to Dinner. So today is the 20th birthday of the American Airlines Theater, and I thought that we should shout it out. We can't wait. I mean, they get so many great stars. They just had Soldiers play there. It's such a fantastic place. But anyway, that's today's Today in Broadway.
Very nice. Happy birthday.
Did you know any of that? You know, I actually
know.
In the 90s, before all these theaters got fixed up, they did shows there in them when they were like disheveled. And I went and saw Willem Dafoe star in The Hairy Ape in the Selwyn Theater. And it was like a train wreck, but the show was amazing. Oh, it's gorgeous. And it's,
I guess
it's
that's actually, what matters, right?
Yeah. And actually the seats are pretty comfortable there too. So thanks for that Roundabout Theater. Huh. Hey, Charlie, will you please tell everyone about today's guest?
Yes, I can. Hey guys, so today joining us is Sydney Lucas and Eli Tokash talking all about their new podcast, Take a Bow, which explores what it's like to be a teenager in the entertainment business and seeks advice from veteran performers. Sydney is known for starring in Fun Home and earning a Tony nomination at just 11 years old. Eli has been on Broadway in Finding Netherland and Pippin. Follow them on Instagram and social media in general, at Take a Bow Podcast, at Sydney Lucas New York NYC, and at Tokash_Eli. Leave all your questions in the comments below, and please welcome Sydney, Eli, and Paul.
Come on in, come on in.
Hey, everyone.
Hello. Hi, guys.
Oh, your mug.
How are you doing? Thank you for joining. Eli, am I saying your last name right?
It's Tokash, but it's completely fine.
Tokash.
I haven't saved
as put money.
Yeah, I literally have his name saved in my phone as Toe Cash.
Yeah, well, that's how I would have written it down. Thank you for that tip, Sydney. You know, it's funny, sometimes you like see someone's name over and over, but you never actually, you realize like, this is one thing about doing this, and you might find this now that you're broadcasting stars yourself, that sometimes you're like, wait, I've never actually said that name out loud.
Yeah.
Like,
it's
just, you think it all the time. So anyway, Toe Cash.
Yeah.
Get into it.
Okay. I'll get, thank you.
Toe Cash Cab. Anyway. Yeah. Hi, guys.
Hi.
Good to meet you both. So you, you know, I've been listening to you all day. You are on the Broadway Podcast Network, which is a big thing now. And you have a podcast, and it's called Take a Bow, like I said. And did you know that's a Madonna song, or are you too young to even know that?
I didn't
originally.
It's a really good song.
I figured it out later, but I didn't know it originally.
And here's a fun fact. She, you know, Madonna is fantastic, but she's not known necessarily for, I love your Newsies mug. She's not necessarily known for her singing, but that's a beautifully sung song because she recorded it while she was training to do Evita. So she actually was like deep in vocal training when she recorded. Anyway, just a fun fact about Take a Bow. How did you guys up with the name Take a Bow? Because coming up with the title, I find it stressful.
Oh, Eli did.
Oh, yeah. It was actually like my mom and I, we were thinking, because Sydney and I had a lot of options and, you know, we were trying to like combine our names, especially because it's like Sid and E, like we could do something like City, kind of like we were playing with those ideas. And then eventually we were just like, you know, like why we want it to be Broadway based, but at the same time, it's also like Broadway people have also been on like TV and film. So we didn't want to leave that out. So we just felt like in the entertainment industry in general, we all deserve to like take a bow and appreciate each other. And eventually that's how that came out to be. And then when we saw this logo that a friend of ours created for us, we definitely were like, yeah, this is it.
Oh yeah, totally.
So Eli, from what I've learned, you posted something cryptic on Snapchat.
Yeah.
Right? Sydney, why don't you take it? Why don't you tell me what you saw on Snapchat?
Ooh, I'll take the beginning. So yeah, Eli posted something really cryptic on Snapchat. He was basically like, oh, good things are in the works. And I swiped up, and then Eli, you can take it from there because it was his idea to begin with.
Yeah,
big things in the works, very dramatic.
And I was like, what's going on?
I mean, listen, I've gotten into podcasts in the past like 2 years, and I've listened to like podcasts about like even school. Like when I had a math test, I would listen to like a math podcast on the way to the subway, like on my subway ride. And then I listened to like sports podcasts, and then Josh Lehman came out with a podcast. And then I was like, whoa, this is like something that like can actually happen. Like I could have a podcast.
I could be Josh Lehman.
Yeah. Right. I mean, yeah. I mean, He's the best. But eventually I was like, you know, this is like not impossible. So
I have to comment on the mug game that Sydney.
I know. How many mugs do you have?
That mug says this. What does it say? So you're, how old are you? You're 16. How old are you?
I'm 17 now.
17. Sorry.
My dad
has a scotch because she's 17 and she's an actress.
Don't worry. It's my dad's.
And Eli, how old are you?
I'm 17 as well.
Oh my God, the mug. I have so many mugs here. I would have played this game if I knew we were doing it. I'm so mad.
Next time. Yeah. Thank you.
How many do you have?
That's a secret.
Too many. Oh my goodness. Let's all play a game and we can count how many mugs we should win.
I can play that game for a long time.
You guys would notice.
Oh
yeah, I noticed it right away. I love a mug. So you love podcasts.
So eventually, you know, I realized I was looking up the Broadway Podcast Network, and I realized that I had known Dory. And I was like,
who's fantastic. She also produced The Prom, so we love her forever.
Oh my God. And like Legally Blonde, just everything. So eventually, like, I was starting to be like, it was becoming more and more of like a real thing. And Dory and I were talking and all of that. So that after that talk, was actually when I posted that, and she kind of swiped up and was like, what is this? Like, what's going on? And I was like, I don't know if I should say yet. Like, I'm kind of just like leaving it there. And
she was very invasive.
Like, yeah. And she was like, dude, we're best friends. Like, you can tell me these things. And I was like, okay, fair. Like, I'm starting a podcast. I've liked it a lot for the past couple years, and I've always wanted to like have my own. And then she was texting, and she was like, oh my God, no way. Like, you'll have to have me on. And I was like,
she's like, I'm a Tony nominee. I'm kind of
She's like, do you know who I am? I'm Sydney Lucas. You can have me on. And so I was like, wait a second. So I did some thinking, and like I called my manager and like talked to my family, and I was like, I mean, I wanted to have a co-host anyways. Like, I don't know. I feel like it would have been awkward if it was just me. And so when she said that, I was like, I wonder if there's a chance that she would want to do this with me. Like, it's a big commitment, but I'm not, but who knows? It doesn't hurt to ask.
He texted me like 20 minutes later being like, can I call you? I'm like, okay.
Yeah. So long story short, I called her, and eventually she hopped on board, and we've been just going ever since.
Now you're 9 episodes in. It's a lot of fun. You've had some friends on, some fancy people. Who's been the most stressful person to interview so far?
Oh, all of them have been so great. All of them are so warm and just like truly fantastic guests. Really, we have some great guests coming up.
Yeah. We've in the beginning, we were like super stressed. I remember like our first interview, Sydney, our first interview was actually Josh.
It was Josh. He has his own, but it's like,
yeah, he was like, I was comfortable with him. He knows what's going on with podcasts, blah, blah, blah. But Sydney had never met Josh and she was like really nervous. And I was like, dude, like, it's okay. Like it's Josh. He's like,
the nicest guy ever. and
honestly, like it wasn't until like I didn't know the guest where I felt what she was feeling. Cause when I knew the guest, I was more comfortable. But when I didn't, I was kind of like, what's going on?
I have to say, we have such a newfound respect for interviewers and hosts because, like, I was very intimidated by the prospect of interviewing someone. Yeah, we're learning, and it's not easy. So props to like people like you who are doing interviews and hosting stuff.
I'll take it. You guys, the fashion coordination game is really good, though. Do you guys do this all the time?
You got it.
Okay, so literally, we were so excited about this because we just recorded a new episode at like 2 o'clock with Anthony Rosenthal. So it'll be coming up soon. Yeah. Keep an eye out. And he's hilarious. So it was super fun.
Yeah.
So Sydney and I have tried to coordinate, but every time we do, we're always like, oh, like let's wear purple. And we always have like bizarre shades of purple that just like don't look good together. And so we were just like, screw it. And for the past couple times, like we haven't been coordinating. And today we hopped on with Anthony and we were like, no way. Like every time we don't coordinate, it works out.
Can I tell you what? Every single time we coordinate, it's horrible. Every single time we don't coordinate, we are like really weirdly matchy-matchy.
It's like really matchy-matchy or we complement each other's clothes.
Yeah. So it's just like weird, really funny thing.
That's amazing. So you guys are actually best friends or is this just a press, like a spin? Are you just lying to make it sound good?
Guy.
Yeah, she annoys me. She's on my nerves.
Where did you meet? How did you meet?
So we met, he was actually in A Christmas Story with my brother Jake. He was the alternate for Ralphie. And so they shared that role. And I met him then, but then we went to middle school together. And we kind of were the first faces that we saw and we kind of clung to each other like, oh, I know you, okay.
Yeah, especially because I'm not from New York. So, like, a lot of people in my middle school had already known each other. And just, like, my first day of school was actually late because I moved to New York, right, like, literally the first day of school. But I didn't go – like, I didn't have a spot there yet. And then eventually I somehow got in. And then I saw Sydney.
She's a nominee.
Unbelievable.
She got that in the bag.
And so when I got in and like everyone had their friend groups and everything and I saw Sydney, I automatically like clung to her. And ever since then, like we've been like gotten closer with each other and have kind of depended on each other and leaned on each other.
What's the biggest misconception about professional children?
Ooh, that were like super like pretentious. And also, a misconception is that the parents are driving it. In Eli and my case, our parents are like the most supportive people in the entire world, and we're the ones driving it, and they're supporting and.
Everyone assumes that you have Mama Rose waiting at home.
Yeah. That's not the case at all.
Right. Good. I'm glad. Yeah. I've met your family, Sydney. They're lovely.
Yeah.
Thank you.
But it's like you guys are both like really like you have amazing careers. I mean, like you know, film, TV, theater. Like you're doing it all, and it's crazy. And what I was thinking is really crazy is that neither of you look like how you looked when you started. Like it's so weird to be like going.
I would be concerned if I did.
It's like growing up while you're known, like. Yeah. It's very strange because it makes people like me feel like I've known you like through your life, which is you know, strange because like we see you grow.
We've grown up in front of everyone.
Yeah, but I wonder what's it like for you. But what's it like for you to sort of be like, well, I'm a different person now. Like I'm turning into an adult, and I'm a teenager, and it's just interesting.
It's pretty sketchy. I mean, that's also another reason why we wanted to do the podcast, was because we're in a very unique position where we've been child actors and now we're teenage actors transitioning into adult actors. So the audiences get to join us on this journey of navigating the two completely different worlds as we go through it. So we'll see.
For sure.
Hey.
For sure.
That's my thing.
Eli needs a for sure mug.
Oh my god.
We were just talking about that. We need to create like a shirt and like mugs.
For sure.
within like
everything. It's addictive.
It's so good.
Within like weeks of listening to him, I all of a sudden started picking it up, and my family was like, "What are you doing?" And also, we got our listeners also are picking it up.
For sure.
Yeah.
It's really cool.
We've gotten a bunch of messages saying.
Response, for sure.
It's nice to have a thing. You have a thing. That's good. Hey, let's bring Charlie back in because we have some fan questions.
Yeah.
Awesome.
Let's entertain those questions, shall we?
So guys, Gally E on YouTube wants to know if you guys have any dream roles.
I think my dream role is one that hasn't been written yet.
Ooh.
It's like,
I'll be right back. You keep talking.
Oh, see you later. I think it's one that hasn't been written yet. Maybe one that I might write someday.
I was gonna ask that.
Maybe, yeah.
How about you, Eli?
Yeah, similar. I mean, I've never been in an original Broadway cast, so I really want to check that off the bucket list. So definitely one that hasn't been written yet. But I mean, I feel like for every teenager, like, it's like Evan Hansen or like something fun in Hamilton. Like, I don't know. There's so many like amazing shows on Broadway. Also, Seymour and Little Shop of Horrors would be really
cool. That's a great one.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
All right, so Jenny on Twitter wants to know what you remember most about making your Broadway debut.
For each of you, what was your Broadway debut? What was the night?
Okay, I'll go first. My Broadway debut was Pippin, and it was July 3rd. And funny enough, I made the second show that I made my debut in was also on July 3rd. And both were... Yeah, and both were directed by Diane Paulus, and like it was just like these crazy full circle moments.
It's a good friend. It's a good friend to have.
Yeah, right.
Exactly.
So my first one was Pippin, and I remember like making my Broadway debut with so many people because Pippin wasn't like a Broadway like actor show. Like it was, but like at the same time there was a bunch of circus performers, and so when I went in, I was going in with a bunch of circus performers, and so like none of us knew what to expect. Like I had no clue. Like I didn't really know much about Broadway. Like I was just like going out there. But I remember like Kyle D. Massey and Rachel Bay Jones and people like that, like just telling me to relax and like have fun and enjoy it. And at the time, like I didn't understand it because I was like 11, 12 years old. And like now looking back on it, I'm always like, I always remember that. And that resonates with me now, just how I wish I would have soaked it in more.
Yeah, same. I made my Broadway debut in Fun Home. And I think the thing that
That was good.
Thank you.
Perfect timing for that mug, huh?
Thank you.
No way.
Wait, what? What?
Playing along now.
No. Okay. So I think what I remember about it most is the fact that, you know, most of the cast had been in it for years and years and years. So, like, I started in the lab of Fun Home, moved to the off-Broadway run of Fun Home, then the Broadway run of Fun Home. So, like, when we made our Broadway debuts, it almost didn't feel like a Broadway debut, but we were doing it together. I think that's what I remember about it most.
Love that. Juliana wants to know, so you guys have interviewed several people. Wait, you guys know Juliana?
Yeah, she's in our class.
Which Juliana?
She wants to know who your dream podcast guest is.
Oh, we got
Juliana.
That's amazing. Oh, my God. So do you want to take that one first?
Yeah, I got it. Kate McKinnon is my dream podcast
guest,
for sure, yeah.
I've always said that either like Ben Platt or Grant Gustin would be like a really cool one for me to have on. I don't know, but Kate is definitely up there too.
Yeah,
we have some like ideas to do stuff with like SNL people, like hopefully.
All right, Lauren wants to know, which of your past shows do you think you could go back into the easiest, still remembering the blocking and everything too?
Hey, Lauren.
Good photo, Lauren.
She's like one of our number one supporters. She always listens and always, she's the best. She's so nice.
Fun Home. Like, because I was in it for like so long. And interestingly enough, when I went from the off-road run of Fun Home to the Broadway run of Fun Home, the first day, I like didn't have my script because I was like, I can do it. And then first day of rehearsal for Broadway Fun Home, I had my script because I didn't have my script because I thought I could do it. And then I go up there to do the opening. I didn't know anything, but now I think I could do it. I they were like, Sydney, go get your script. But now I do think I could do it. I think it's muscle memory.
So wait, would you ever play medium Allison, an adult out? Like, would you want? Don't we need to see that happen throughout your career?
Oh, it's happening.
You could be in every revival of Fun Home.
Hopefully. That would be sick. Yeah.
Yeah, that would be awesome.
Okay, let's do that.
Yeah, let's make it happen. Anyone?
Let's make it happen.
What about you, Eli?
I want to say Finding Neverland or Trevor, because both were like pretty recent. I mean, not pretty recent.
Yes, you did the Trevor musical that was in Chicago, right?
Yeah, I did. And I mean, it was like I was on the stage a lot, but luckily there wasn't too much dancing. So I feel like I could easily just like step into that. And same with Finding Neverland, just because like I was in it for so long and I just did it pretty much every night. And I feel like it was just like a show that I still sing and all of that.
Which part in Finding Neverland? Because didn't you like play like every part?
Oh yeah, that's true. I mean, definitely like Jack and Peter. I don't. Mm-hmm. I may need like a reminder of George and Michael. But
wasn't George the one who played ukulele?
Yeah.
You would have to
brush one out. That I can still do that.
Okay.
I take pride in that because that's like why I know how to play the ukulele is because I can play like that song and those chords, you know.
Love that.
Also, like I did the Mary Poppins tour, and I feel like Supercalifragilistic will like stick with me forever. Like,
that was a hard number, wasn't it?
Oh my God, it was bizarre, but it was so much fun. And like, I literally just still walk around the house just like doing it. It's just like weird muscle memory that just doesn't leave your body. It's really cool though.
Uh-huh.
I've been singing that song lately.
No way. That's so funny. I should teach you the dance.
You should. Yes.
All right. I don't think we have any more questions.
Do you guys want to do you have any like adult roles that you would want to do together like in like 10 years? Interesting question.
Yeah, we've never thought about that. That'd be pretty cool. I've always wanted, Sydney and I have always said like we wanted to do a show together because like we haven't worked together, but we've been like such good friends for the past 7 years. So now like that we have this podcast, we're excited that we're able to actually work with each other. But I haven't actually thought of, do you have any ideas on like roles?
I don't know. I'm going to have to work it out. I'm going to have to think about it.
Yeah.
Once again, maybe we'll write our own. Who knows?
Right.
Sure.
You're entitled. Sure.
Well, for yourself.
I have another question.
Yeah.
Where are you in your school? Where are you in your school? And what's your deal now? Because everyone's talking about school. And what's your deal? What's your deal right now with education?
So currently we are looking. We are basically working on college applications. So it's a very interesting thing to do during quarantine. But so we're basically, you know, trying to figure out what college we're going to go to, and, you know, write our essays.
So wait, you're about to be seniors?
Yeah, we're both entering our senior year.
Okay, got it. Okay, cool. Ish.
That's true.
I have a quick question. So I know last year a ton of kids were using social media to perform their parts in theater that they didn't get to perform at the end of the year because school ended, essentially.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Is there any advice that you would give kids this year who might not be going back to school, who might be homeschooled because of coronavirus, but might still want to get that like community going, that theater community that they're used to when they're in school?
Yeah, well, that's why it was so important for us to do this at this time, like, especially when there's no Broadway shows to, like, not, like, nothing can compare to Broadway, but, like, to somehow bring Broadway to people and keep that community alive.
Yeah.
But honestly, just, like, keep working at it because, you know, like, you can never stop working at it, even if you just, like, sing it around your house. Like, that exercises those muscles and that continues to your passion and love for it, and it just grows it. And I feel like it's super important to just like throw stuff out there, even if it's like when you do sing, like video it, and then who knows, you can send it to someone if you really, really yeah. like it. Just build up the courage.
I think we have the blessing of technology and we can use that to our advantage. You know what I mean? We can make, yeah. we can still do it. We just have to video ourselves and be a little bit creative, but I think we still got it. And I mean, it's the reason, you know, I know.
And that's so cool because, like, during this time, it's been so incredibly inspiring to see how the Broadway community has, reacted to this situation and knowing that, like, we have this technology now. So, like, why not use it to our advantage? And we're all, like, trying to create our own entertainment for people and just try to put new stories out there and have fun, like, and stay busy at the same time. Because as creative people, you always want to try to exercise your mind, you know?
Yeah.
Amazing. Well, I love that you guys are doing Take a Bow. So what day of the week do new episodes come out? What day is it released?
Thursday.
Yeah, every Thursday.
Yeah.
Every Thursday. And you have a really super popular person on this Thursday. So people need to go subscribe. Find out who it is. They should go subscribe. I can't wait to keep listening. And I love that you guys are doing so much. I mean, it's so crazy how many like episodes you already have under your belt. And it's very inspiring.
Thank you. We appreciate
Thank
that.
You so much.
Thank you so much for coming in. What, do you have something else you want to say?
No, I'm good.
Thank you so much for coordinating. I love it. Thank you for the mug show. I'm into it. I have one more. I have I'm only gonna show that much.
I'm nervous because there's water in all of these.
Oh my god. I can't
show the whole fantastic. Thing. These
stupid things.
Mr. That Fantastic, that's incredible. Oh my god.
No, it's fantastic.
Yeah.
Sure. I don't know how to put these down.
For it's sure. very fitting.
Thank you so much, Eli and Sydney. It was so much fun to have you here. Hey Charlie.
Hey.
Please take us out.
Yes, thank you guys so much for joining us today for a new episode of Live at 5 Home Edition. You can listen to us wherever you get your podcasts by searching for hashtag Live at 5 and hitting that subscribe button. Be sure to tune in tomorrow for another incredible roundtable discussion hosted by Michael James Scott. Taking us out today is an incredible rendition of The Lady is a Tramp from CBS Sunday Morning, performed by Christiane Pitts, Jelani Aladdin, and Richard Rias Yoder.
Lovely.